This is Jay Allen, and you're watching me on Biker New England TV.
Hey guys, I'm Jody Perowitz, and you're watching me on Biker New England TV.
Hi, I'm Dave Perowitz, and you're watching me on Biker New England TV.
Welcome back to Biker New England, the only biker show in New England that's locally produced. I'm pretty sure that it's the only one on the East Coast that's locally produced. You're not going to see any fathers and sons arguing over motorcycles and throwing wrenches and stuff at each other. That's nonsense. That's not entertainment. They do build some beautiful motorcycles, though, if they just keep it focused on that. Speaking of beautiful motorcycles, before I introduce Spike, Spike is a world-class custom painter. Before I introduce him, I want to remind everybody that, you know, we're covering motorcycling from, like I always say, from the young boy or girl that buy their first mini bike or scooter or whatever it is, right up until all the major motorcycle clubs in the world. And everybody in between, all right? So we're not picking and choosing. Nobody runs the show. We run the show, all right? We may have guests at times that other people don't like, and you know, that's don't watch us. What can I tell you? I'm not here to gear a show to any one person's liking. This is about the motorcycling community, and that covers an awful lot of people. It's a rich culture. Some of the best people I've ever met in my life, honest to God. And today, we've got a gentleman that paints like you will not believe. And as we're talking about this different motorcycles that he's painted, you'll see some of the motorcycles come up on the screen. You can find him at spikescustompaint.com. That's spikescustompaint.com. Spike, my brother, good to see you. Thank you for being here with us.
Thank you very much for having me.
Now, you and I, we've talked several times in the past. And
yes.
You've been on my radio and you've been on my YouTube. You are on my YouTube. You paint some of the best stuff I've ever seen. And there's a lot of talented painters out there. You know, tell us what it is that got you involved in the motorcycling thing and in painting.
Well, my family is... My family was pretty much all bikers. My grandfather rode, my grandmother rode, my aunt rode. They all had their own bikes. My father rode, my stepfather rode. So, and my grandfather was a mechanic, and I spent a lot of time growing up with him. So that kind of rubbed off. So I started out as a mechanic, cars mostly, you know, working on my cars and learning how to do different stuff. And then I began as a line mechanic at a General Motors dealership, and I was there for a while. And it was in the 70s, so computers were starting to come into cars, and it got to be a lot more attention than I wanted to devote to it, because I was young. I wanted to party. I wanted to chase women and do all the good stuff. So I thought, well, you know, maybe I really like design. When I was 10, I was always drawing cars, drawing motorcycles, just drawing, you know, during class where everybody else is talking. So finally I decided, well, maybe I should just go do bodywork. So I found a shop, a small shop, and they did a little bit of custom paint. You know, they did like some candy apples and stuff, but nobody was doing airbrushing. But next door was Van America, who was very big in the 70s. And over there was Rocky and Bowler. They had teamed, a couple of guys had teamed up, and Rocky was a phenomenal airbrush artist, doing lots of Frazettas and Boris Vallejos and all that stuff on the sides of vans. And it was just the coolest thing. So mm-hmm. I was like, I have to do that. And so, you know, I was in a body shop, so I started painting and learning how to, you know, fix the cars. And then at home, I screwed around with the airbrush. I got off the Snap-on guy, and before you know it, I just kind of kept doing it and just making a living in the body shop field and mechanic field and whatever, and fine-tuning my craft, I guess you could say, learning, because I didn't go to school. There's science schools and stuff. I probably should have went. Maybe I'd be better. I don't know. But it seems like Eddie Van Halen's a great guitarist, never took a lesson, right?
I can't see you getting much better, man, and better at all. I mean, well, you're there.
It's a matter of putting together the different skills is all it is, really. I mean, it's not all that complicated. I guess I say that because I can draw. I had a guy that was painting for me when I was running a restoration shop, and I was wicked busy, and I didn't have time to lay out some flames one day. So I said, well, Brian, just go lay out some flames. He's like, I can't do it. I said, well, just here, take a panel. Just try it. You'll be able to do it. And he came back like 2 hours later, and it was atrocious. And I said, well, you're right. You can't right. paint flames. I'll get to it when I can. So, I don't know. It's just I've always just liked to stay in the trade and try to learn new things. I don't experiment as much as some guys because I'm just too busy. I mean, I've got work. So do I do the work and learn how to do it as I need it, or do I sit down and spend 10 hours a day practicing and different techniques, and somebody may never come in and want that?
You know. I remember one of the, you moved her table.
Oh,
she is going to kill you.
She's gonna kill me.
So, anyway, fear the woman.
We won't do that again, I swear.
One of the first times, I believe it may have been the first time I ran across you and your artwork, which is incredible, was at the Springfield Motorcycle Show several years ago. This year was the 14th show that they've done.
Yeah.
I've been bouncing around here for around 11 years doing some video stuff.
Yeah, you've been there almost as long as I've been. It's been open. I've been going too.
Some of the bikes that you had an area that had probably half a dozen bikes in there, and one of them had the money, the dollar bills. And I was like, I videotaped that and stared at that thing, and I was like, how the heck did he do this? It's an incredible bike. How long did it take you to do that paint job? Do you recall?
Probably a couple weeks.
Yeah.
So it was a dresser, there's a lot more involved. Yeah. But just to do the artwork alone took probably 3 days, 4 days.
Well, people don't realize. I would have no idea on what it takes to do that because I haven't done that. But, you know, there are things that we all do, you know, that other people don't do and they don't experience.
Right.
In this industry here, you know, setting up here, there are people behind the cameras that you can't see and in the control room.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's editing, and I know what it takes to edit because I edit my shows. And if I'm not doing a show like here, right, this makes it a lot easier for me because most of the stuff is taped here.
Yeah.
Then I just throw in what I need to throw in later.
Right.
But from going from scratch to do a half-hour show, you know, you can do anywhere between 20 and 60 hours of editing. Oof. For a half-hour show, and I used to do a one-hour show. So, you know, I know what pains you go through, you know. But when you watch a show on TV, it's over in a half hour, you just go about your business, you have no idea.
Right.
So when we see a motorcycle that looks like the stuff you put out, people go to the shows, take pictures of it, video of it, and they're like, that's awesome, that's beautiful. They have no idea what it takes to do that.
Yeah.
What's the longest you've spent on a paint job, time-wise?
Probably 200 to 300 hours.
Yeah,
you know, and the funny part is the airbrushing. Like myself and some other airbrush friends of mine, they can. When you're doing freehand airbrushing, it goes a lot faster. Mm-hmm. If you're doing graphics, like just say stripes and stuff, that takes a lot longer, especially on a motorcycle, because you got to get both sides the same. Lots of measuring, lots of taping, checking. Tape off in advance so you know where you're going to end up when you finally get this part painted and you get to that part, it'll be where you want it. But when it's freehand airbrush, you know, you can pretty much pick it up and go. But I was over a friend of mine's house one day. I was too busy doing some stuff, so I gave him a job to do, and he's a great airbrush artist. He's far more talented than I am, freehand for sure. And I watched him for a while, and he walked around and he paced and he mixed his paint and then he cleaned his brush, and now an hour's gone by and we haven't started yet, and I'm like, you know, when are we going to get going here? And then I found myself doing the same thing in my shop, and it seemed to be a pattern, and I was glad to see that somebody else actually did it, because I'll mix the paint, I'll clean my brush. It's like you got to build up the courage to go at that panel, and you can't just go at it. You got to kind of get the courage up, and then finally you go. And then sometimes I started to realize I take like 2-3 hours of walking around and prepping and
before
getting mentally prepared to do a half hour piece of art.
Absolutely.
Which you sit down, it's all done. What was all that about? What was all that walking around about, wasting time?
Let me ask you this. Have you found yourself, I don't consider myself an artist in any way, but I can edit. All right?
Yeah.
And so, but I find myself on days that I know I need to edit, I don't want to. Some days I just don't have it in me to do that.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
And the times that I've done it reluctantly, it shows in my work.
Oh, it does.
It shows, it's like, you know, this is rushed. You know what I mean? This is not good. So
it's kind of like I have a routine that
you've
I go
got
through.
It right. The same thing
yeah. that you. Yeah. Have you found yourself wanting to do on any particular day, get into the painting and on a bike that you've either started or are starting and felt like I don't have it
not today.
Not today. I don't have it in me today.
Yeah, that probably goes on a lot. But I've got so much different stuff going on in the shop. At any given time, I probably got something I'm building over here, welding, fabricating, bending steel, making something. And then I've got stuff that's been painted 2 weeks ago and it needs to be buffed. And then I've got stuff that needs to have flames taped off and sprayed. And then I've got stuff that needs to be prepped and primered and the body work done. So when I don't feel like airbrushing, that's not a problem.
Yeah.
There's plenty to do. So while I'm trying to get up the courage, I'll go over here and I'll work some steel or maybe I'll buff something until I feel like, okay, now's a good time. Now let's focus on that.
At your facility. I've been at your shop. You have a very cool shop.
I like to you think of it as my little assembly
shop.
Line. Yeah, everybody.
That tells me something about when I first saw your shop, I said to myself, this is crazy clean, man. This is not a paint. You got a paint booth in there, and I mean, you're set up, but everything is in its place, and everything is clean.
Pretty much.
You know, and I find that because I've been through, some other painters' booths and their shops and stuff.
I know you got to kick the trash away just to walk through the room.
some of the biggest names in the industry, and yours is the cleanest by far. Mm-hmm. What we're going to do here is I'm going to take a quick break, and we're going to come back, and we're going to finish our discussion. We're talking to Spike right now, a world-class custom painter. You got to check out his work at SpikesCustomPaint.com. They do automobiles as well. I mean, crazy talented. We'll be right back.
Your kids probably have one of these, right? Not quite. Hell of a pilot? No. That skill is all AI. It's flying itself. Its processor can react 100 times faster than a human. The stochastic motion is an anti-sniper feature. Just like any mobile device these days, it has cameras and sensors, and just like your phones and social media apps, it does facial recognition. Inside here is 3 grams of shaped explosive. This is how it works. Did you see that? That little bang is enough to penetrate the skull and destroy the contents. Now, trust me, these were all bad guys. Now that is an airstrike of surgical precision. It's one of a range of products. Trained as a team, they can penetrate buildings, cars, trains, evade people, bullets, pretty much any countermeasure. They cannot be stopped. Now, I said this was big. Why? Because we are thinking big. Watch. $25 million order now buys this. Enough to kill half a city. The bad half. Nuclear is obsolete. Take out your entire enemy, virtually risk-free. Just characterize him, release the swarm, and rest easy.
This short film is more than just speculation. It shows the results of integrating and miniaturizing technologies that we already have. I'm Stuart Russell, a professor of computer science at Berkeley. I've worked in AI for more than 35 years. Its potential to benefit humanity is enormous, even in defense. But allowing machines to choose to kill humans will be devastating to our security and freedom. Thousands of my fellow researchers agree. We have an opportunity to prevent the future you just saw, but the window to act is closing fast.
Welcome back. Hey, listen, the spots you see before, the, in between the last segment we're doing this segment, you know, pay attention to those people, pay attention to the business, especially the attorney, James Maniatis. You find him at maniatislaw.com. Very, very experienced accident attorney, real estate. I mean, the guy, I've tried to get him on the show. He doesn't want to be on the show. He doesn't like that kind of attention. But I'm telling you something. He's been more than generous. He's the real reason this show has life, all right? And he's an experienced motorcycle accident attorney, and he's a friend, and he's a great human being. You won't hear me say that a lot about a lot of attorneys, believe me. And if you've ever watched my shows in the past, you know that I don't mince words. I'm right to it. He's a great human being. Check him out again, maniatislaw.com. So we're talking with Spike, and Spike's one of those guys that has a talent that he's humble in the sense that he doesn't really like to talk about the talent that he has in a way that should. And I've tried this before. You remember when I was at your place last time? I said it's a blessing. And you're like, well, it's more like a process. Remember that?
Yeah. Well, I break it down. You know, it's just.
So this blessing comes through to you as a process, right? So which makes it, I guess, right. Easier for you to explain, I guess, or not.
Yeah. There are guys out there, and my friend that I was talking about that did the airbrushing, that's how he's just like, he's out there. Yeah. There's all kinds of stuff going on in his head. You can hardly have a conversation with him sometimes, you know. I'm not that kind of artist. I'm more like a craftsman. And because I don't just do airbrush, you know, I do so many things. So, and that's what I think in the automotive trade, especially in the body part of it. There's so many different skills involved, welding and buffing and painting and all that stuff. So it is a process. So I guess that's how I look at it, because each thing has to be done before we get to that part. So if it's going to be airbrushing, there's a lot of prep work that has to be done in between, and then there's stuff that has to be done after.
Your shop bike.
Yeah.
Life Behind Bars.
Yeah.
How long did it take you to put that project together?
That was a little time consuming, because when I started with the basic tribal graphic that went through it in black, I just sprayed that over the white pearl, and then I had to go back and cover it, and then do all the air, the fade, the blend fade, and the outlines and that stuff like that. So that was pretty time consuming, even though when you look at it, it's pretty simple looking. You know, it's not real complicated stuff, but it took a while, and it took a while to put it together. So I did it. That was like one of the second or third ones I actually kind of did on the computer. Took a picture of the bike with all the new parts on it, laid out the graphic. Kind of did the blends on the computer so I could get an idea of what it looked like, which is what I like to do for customers. If I've got a customer that comes in with, wants to do the complete paint on their bike, and they've got some ideas, graphic-wise or airbrush-wise, I try to put it on the computer so they can kind of get an idea of what it's going to look like when it's done. And me too, because I don't want to do something and then when it's done go, I wish I had done this, I wish I did that. And it's on the computer, so now I can see it. I got a good idea what needs to be changed, if the line doesn't look right. And so I had done that on there, and then I've got pictures of it. So it's kind of good if somebody comes in and we get talking, and they get, well, I wish I could see it before I do it.
Right.
Well, I know the feeling. I'd like to know too. Right. So it works out good. I can do it on there for them. They get a rough idea. They feel a little more confident. And of course, the finished product is way nicer than what you're going to see on the computer, because it's real. It's three-dimensional.
Last year's Springfield Motorcycle Show. The 2018 show.
Yeah.
You were there in full force with a crew of guys. What's the name?
American Muscle.
American Muscle
down in Granby.
I got to get them in.
Granby, Connecticut, rather.
Right. I got to get them in here.
They had.
You guys won
four or five.
Yeah, four or five bikes there. You won everything.
Yeah.
Now there was a. there was a trike there that looks like it went 500 miles an hour. But the other one, the one I want to talk about first is the one that you did. It's like a Chicano bike.
Oh, right? The Cholo bike.
A lot of gold leaf work there.
Yeah, gold leaf.
How long did it take you to do that job?
That one was a metal flake root beer base with some gold leaf striping, some candy fades, and that took. We did that just before the show, or no? I think we did that one in the summer, and finished it probably a month before the show. But it took. Well, see, that's the thing. You know, it takes a while. You spray the candy. Now you wait. You sand it all down, and maybe it takes you, I don't know, 3-4 hours to put the leaf on, and then you clear it and walk away. Come back, sand it again, put the pinstripes on. You know, sometimes you want to do that. I like to do that in between some stuff because I've got it to this point. I don't want to ruin that much. So if I clear it, we're good from here. We can do what else, and if it doesn't work out, we can wash it off and do something different, you know. And that bike was, there wasn't really a plan. Tony came, the guy that owns American Muscle, he came and he said, well, I'd like some flake, I like lace work, I like gold leaf, I like blends, do something. So I thought, well, we put that together and it worked out pretty good. And then he had the chrome all etched.
Yes.
All great engraved. So then it was awesome because now it has all these little Muerta faces on it and stuff. You know, it's pretty cool.
It's a hot bike. That's a very beautiful bike.
In fact, that bike's going to be an easy rider.
Oh, is that
right? They already took the photo shoot, and it's just when it comes up.
Awesome. Yeah. Now the other one was the excuse me. They had a the trike there. Tell us a little bit about that trike.
You must be thinking the V-Rod.
I think that thing was that, what kind of bike did that start out as? Was that
the silver one, the V-Rod with the flames?
The V-Rod.
Right. Yeah, it's a V-Rod.
Yeah, silver. Yeah.
They put a trike kit on it.
Yeah.
They put a...
With the wheels in the back. With the...
Pro Street tires you'd have on a car.
Well, not only that, the little wheels, the rack, to keep it from flipping
over.
Yeah,
he's got the wheelie bars on it. Yeah. I don't know if he's going to twist that thing up and see what it'll do, but it's a pretty crazy looking thing.
Oh, yeah, that was hot. And then they had the little black bike.
Like old school one, all black with just some pinstripe.
Beautiful. Yeah. Great work. I mean, listen, I got to tell you, honestly, I know a few bike painters, and they're all world class. And some of them are very, 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 very successful. Millions of dollars they've made over the years. Literally, this guy here though, he could be a millionaire. I don't care if he's a millionaire or not. Let me tell you something. For me, the best bike painter I've seen around these parts. Not out of lack, don't get a couple of guys angry at me, you know what I mean?
You're being way too kind.
but I mean, so much so that I zeroed in on a trike for the company. And I thought I was gonna have it last season and I didn't, I'll have it this year. And he's going to be the guy painting it for me, for my company. It's going to be the company trike with the company logo, and we'll go over that. But he's the guy, you know, of all the guys that I know, you know, that I could hire to do it, he's the guy that's going to be doing it. But tell us a little bit about your contact information so people can get a hold of you.
My website's spikescustompaint.com, and I've got a pretty good Facebook. My Spikes Custom Paint Facebook page has a lot of newer stuff on it and probably more of the arty stuff. My website got so full and there's so much information on there that, you know, I really kind of did it like 4 or 5 years ago. And every once in a while I'll put something new on it, but pretty much Facebook is where I just kind of do it. I don't know why. I'm not a big Facebook fan, but there's a lot of people on Facebook and they like to look at the stuff. You know, I post a little thing and it's no big deal. And next thing you know, I got 50 people going, that's awesome. I want to see more. So I'll put some more.
It's incredible. You know, my website guy, I did my website, Mike, and he's incredible. If you go to the website, all right, it's Biker New England TV. It's important that you put that in there, the TV, because you won't get there otherwise. BikerNewEnglandTV.com. The guy's an incredible website builder, and he kept after me. You got to be on Facebook.
Yeah.
I'm like, no, I was on Facebook many years ago. I've been off Facebook probably 9 years. I haven't been on there.
Yeah.
He says, no, you got to be there for your website.
Right.
You got to be there for the show. You got to be able to promote more. You know, and I fought him for a couple of months, and finally I gave in. You know, and I got a page, and it's incredible. It's like you say, you know, people contact you. They want this. They do that. And, you know. I found a couple of clubs, riding clubs, that I'm going to zero in on. And I mentioned last show, female, all-female club I found there on Facebook out of California called the Head Turners. Classy ladies. I mean, this is good for the motorcycling industry because, you know, now we have it from world-class, high sophisticated women. And you'll see what I mean if you go to their website, headturners.com. It could be headturnersrcridingclub.com, one of those two, but or they're on Facebook. Talking really sophisticated women, mm-hmm. riding these big Harleys, right, that cost anywhere between $20,000 up to $50,000. I mean, but mm-hmm. you got to see them. I mean, even whoever designed their logo and their colors, you know, mm-hmm. incredible, right? And just something that I think that the motorcycling industry needs, you know, because we go from super duper swanky, high-class females that have their own riding club, mm-hmm. and we cover them all. We cover right. we cover 1% of clubs. We cover everybody down to, like I said, the little kids that are just getting involved in it.
Yeah.
Hill climbs, the whole nine yards.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
What is the most gratifying work you've done for yourself? Not so much for a customer, but for yourself. Do you
what
have
kind
one?
Of work or what?
Yeah,
job?
A motorcycle paint job for yourself. I mean, not that you kept, but. Hmm. Made you feel
well. I guess I suffer from the same thing everybody who does it, right? Everyone you do is the best one ever.
That's the best you know? One ever.
That's the best color I ever sprayed. I got to do that on something else.
Nobody can do that, right?
Yeah, it's just like every new project is the best. You know, it just seems like because for me, I never look back. I'm not a person who looks back at anything. Back in my life, back at the last job, it's gone. It's history now. I'm on to the next project. You know, whatever it is, I'm always moving forward. So. Oh, there's a bunch. I guess the $100 bike is that's legendary.
The $100 bill.
I mean, everybody
bike.
Just loves that.
I'm going
to
be putting pictures up on that.
Yeah, everybody loves it.
It's time to go. We got to go. Time flies when we do this. Time flies when you're having fun. That's for sure. Again, we've been speaking with Spike, world class bike painter, cars too. You got to go to his website, spikescustompaint.com. Brother, I want to thank you for being here with us.
Thanks for having me, man.
I know you took a long ride out here on a very cold day to be here, but we appreciate it. And so did our friend. We're doing these shows back to back. All right, so Paul Cody's sitting. He's still sitting here watching, and he was on before him. So we're splitting up the shows. But thank you very much, Paul, for coming in the bad weather all the way from Amesbury. Listen, BikerNewEnglandTV.com. Go there. All right? BikerNewEnglandTV, the show. Tell your friends about it. All right? Very popular show. We're doing it right here on a Charter TV 3.
Hi, I'm Dave Perowitz, and you're watching me on Biker New England TV.
This is Jay Allen, and you're watching me on Biker New England TV.